Thank you for inviting me to participate in the Harvard Museums of Science and Culture's Solstice celebration. The longest day, the standstill, that's what solstice means, the turnaround. It's all about what goes around, and you've heard it all before, the famous cliché. More than a cliché, to everything there is a season and a time, to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. And here are some people doing what comes with the seasons, meaning time douos from the Greeks. That's what it means. It's time that goes around. What goes around comes around. But time isn't a clock. It's not a round thing with a handle on it or a bunch of digital cycles that tell you what to do. In most of the cultures of the world, with the exception of our own contemporary, very busy culture, time is not a clock. It's an activity. It's what you do. And that's the message in the verse of verse number 3 of Ecclesiastes. So let's take a trip. I want us to take a trip around the wheel of time to get to the sun's seasonal high point, this day that we celebrate today, the day of maximum light that's happening. We'll start halfway around time's journey in the dead of winter, the winter solstice, when the sun rises, as you can see in this diagram, farthest to the south, and sets farthest to the south. And there you see its track in the sky. You are at the center. Look at how low in the sky it is in the dead of winter. Will it come back to us? Well, day by day, the sun gradually corkscrews its way ever higher until you get to the spring equinox, where you see it rising exactly in the east and exactly setting in the west. Equinox, equal night, equal day. We're halfway to the solstice at that point. And then the sun goes ever higher in the sky, rising to the north of east, setting to the north of west, and getting about as close to overhead as it can in our latitudes on that day, today. So you can see by looking at the three curves, I didn't show you every day of the movement of the sun, but you can see that this has to be the longest day because it's the biggest curve. And winter solstice, when we beg for the sun to come back, that's the shortest day. The Romans call their winter solstice the dies solis invictus, which means the day of the unconquerable sun. And that was the day when you tried to encourage the sun god, Sol, to return to our northern world, he having departed some time ago, along with the birds and everything else that goes south. How you spend that day, the Romans say, would forecast how you'd spend the rest of the year. So give the gift of sweets, like dates and figs, to the one you love, and decorate your doorway with green branches to anticipate what's ahead. After all, love is the answer. Halfway to the equinox, a quarter of the way to the solstice, we have the next holiday that we celebrate in time's wheel, and enter here a groundhog, and we call him Punxsutawney Phil. You know, he has to see his shadow to predict the weather. If you live in Ohio, it's Buckeye Chuck. If you live in Georgia, it's Beauregard Lee. If you're Canadian, it's Weirton Willie. Over in England, they don't have groundhogs, but they have hedgehogs. So Henrietta Hedgehog is the creature that we celebrate on this day, February 2. It's a badger and a bear in other parts of the old world, and a holiday that dates all the way back to ancient Basque country in northern Spain. It's about the animals that hibernate when it gets cold and waken when the warmth returns to the land. Not about weather predicting, more to do with seeking the groundhog's mate, awakening the procreative juices that accompany the return of the sun. Well, you know, biologists have experimented with groundhogs. They've taken the trouble to take their temperatures. How they manage to do that, I don't know, when they're hibernating. And they noticed that right around the 1st of February, at least in the middle latitudes, the temperature of the body of the animal takes a sudden rise. The testes begin to drop, and we're on the way to procreation. It's no accident, you know, that Valentine's Day follows the Groundhog's Day by a half of a moon cycle. And I think many of you know the popular story of Valentine's Day. It all began when Claudius the Cruel, 3rd century CE Roman emperor, outlawed marriage because it was an exemption to the draft. Mr. Valentine, of course, performed secret marriages. That's the story. He was later sanctified, of course, not before he was jailed. And it was the Valentine messages of thanks that were passed through the bars that gave us our modern Valentines, passed through the bars to St. Valentine for all of the wonderful things he did to try to promulgate marriage in the face of that terrible Claudius the Cruel. By the way, when I wrote my book of the year about seasonal holidays, where many, many of these stories are recounted, particularly of the solstice, I interviewed the head of the chemistry department at Hershey's Chocolate. And he told me in no uncertain terms that it's been proven that phenyl ethyl amine, that molecule that we hear so much about on Valentine's Day, does not get your procreative juices going. Sorry to dismantle another myth by the use of science. When we get to the equinox, the spring equinox, we're halfway to today's date from the dead of winter. And in the Aztec capital Tenochtitlan, Mexico City, the spring equinox was very, very important. A 16th century Spanish chronicler sent to Christianize the Aztecs writes that they began their year when the sun stood in the middle of the great temple. And there you see it in the upper right section with the smoke coming and the fire from behind. When the sun stood in the middle of the great temple, so you can imagine the sun rising in the notch between the temples at the top. But, the chronicler goes on, because the building was poco tuerto, a little bit out of line, a little bit twisted, King Moctezuma needed to tear it down and replace it. There you see the crowd gathered in the plaza awaiting the sun god on his day of the equinox. Just like Times Square, you know, New Year's Eve, waiting for the ball to drop, waiting for the sun and war god Huitzilopochtli to appear in that space in the middle of the temples. You know, they worshipped out of doors in the tropics, Mexico City. No cathedrals with stained glass windows to tell the story of religion for them. But I thought of the job that would have faced Moctezuma's architects to pull that off, to make the sun rise in the middle, as seen from below. You know, the sun rises at an angle. It's not an odd angle. So you've got to calculate and do some careful measurements to get the sun god to appear before that throng situated in the plaza below. Could the temple really work that way? Did the architects actually make it work that way? The answer is yes. And I think I know the answer is yes, because I measured all 7 layers of the then recently excavated facade in downtown Mexico City. And here you're looking at a side view of the Templo Mayor. There are twin stairways. And if you look to the right of the twin stairs, you can see another stairway descending, and above that, another stairway rising. I think it's interesting to see the way the Aztecs and most of the ancient Mexican cultures built over the earlier phases of their buildings as if they wanted to preserve their history. Not us. I remember the theater I used to attend when I was a kid on a Saturday afternoon. It got torn down, changed into a bowling alley. That was torn down, changed into a hair salon. That was torn down, changed into a restaurant. We don't preserve our history inside of our architecture, but the Mexicans certainly did. How did they manage to do this? How did these architects manage to get the alignment so accurately? No surveying equipment, no computers, low tech verging on no tech. I believe the myth of techno-dependence is the source of many false theories about previous lost races or aliens accomplishing feats that sound miraculous when it comes to thinking about the remains of past cultures. Well, they did it with sticks, as I show you here from my book, Ancient Astronomers. They did it with sticks and probably ropes by repeated time-averaged observations made with the naked eye. They didn't have to have that high tech to do it. I got that hint about the sticks from a Mexican manuscript, an ancient Aztec manuscript, showing what looked like an astronomer or some person looking over at the horizon with notched sticks in front of his eye. And I've had my students actually replicate the orientations. It's amazing what you can do without technology. Okay, if you're following me, we're a little bit past halfway to today, to the standstill, the solstice. The new fire ceremony was conducted on that day in Tenochtitlan. They threw out their mats, shattered all their plates, started a new cycle of time. People around the world often begin cyclic transitions in their calendars by lighting fires. And during this new fire ceremony, the Aztecs would bring fuel from the four directions. There you see them depositing it into the fire. And then the citizens would come with their pine sticks and immerse it in the communal fire and bring it to their hearths. Fire is all about purification, and you must cleanse yourself of all the bad things you did in the past cycle, to await a new beginning. I was thinking of our New Year's resolutions, which are a more secular way of thinking of purging all the bad things you do. Of course, the problem with most of those resolutions is we kind of forget about them by January the 10th. But it's the same idea. You've got to fess up to the bad things you did and then go on to a new cycle, totally purified. Well, now we're at the three-quarters mark to the solstice, the summer solstice, and that's May Day. We don't think much about May Day, but it was a very, very important holiday, especially in the Celtic calendar in Europe, halfway from the equinox to the solstice. It's when young people really start to take action in that calendar to bring on the forces of summer, the forces of fertility that come with summer. So they'd take to the woods to bring in the May, flowers and greenery. Then they'd circuit the maypole, imitating the sun's path around the sky. Well, in 1644, Massachusetts Governor William Bradford, while at the Marymount Plantation, was so appalled at the sight of young people, quote, frisking together in beastly bacchanalian practices around a phallic symbol, that he seized the pole and destroyed it. And so we arrive at today, the summer solstice. And where'd you rather be if you couldn't be here at the Harvard Museums? Well, I guess I'd choose Stonehenge, Great Britain's 5,000-year-old megalithic circle, watching the sun rise, as you see it there, over the Healstone. If you've not been there, or should you plan someday to go back, I'd walk it from the River Avon below. That's where they brought up and dragged those stones to assemble the ring. As you rise along that path, you gradually see the megalithic structure emerge from the landscape as though it was sprouting like a plant. And then finally you arrive in the center of the ring from where you're looking out in this picture, arriving at the festival being held inside that ring, just as local tribes did, worshiping the now full blossom of nature's bounty that happens on this day. Prayers of thanks would be given to the gods, accompanied by, I'm sure, a market, probably lots to eat and drink, before we would all go back to our normal business in the course of the movement around time's wheel. We're still doing it today, and I guarantee you there's a scene something like this going on right now at Stonehenge, or at least maybe earlier today. For after all, it's people who own the great architectural statements of the past, from the pyramids of Egypt and Mexico to the United States Capitol. The building and the past belong to us. On this day in the Moselle Valley of 16th century Germany, men in charge of the great solstice fire would spend all day decorating a huge wheel to symbolize the sun. And when the town mayor gave the signal at dusk, men rolled the wheel downhill to the river, imitating the setting sun. But watch closely, for if the fire was extinguished on the way down, It would be a bad fall harvest. No mean task getting that fiery wheel through the vineyards on the hillside. The boldest of these men, fueled by numerous tankards of ale, would dance on the hot ashes afterward to forestall the coming of winter, which happens after the turnaround today. In southern Mexico, I discovered that the earliest archaeological sites like Itzapa, which you see here, were aligned to the place on the horizon where the sun set on the summer solstice. So they were starting their seasonal cycle on one end of the swing of the sun's horizon pendulum, the limit where it turned around. But then came a calendar reform from a different point on the horizon in the seasonal cycle. We're still trying to work out the details of it. But we do know that this reform, which happened fairly early, made sense to a widely and more well-developed agriculture. It was based on the number 20, and it was also based on the day the sun passed overhead, the day the sun passed the zenith. The famous Aztec sunstone offers us a hint, and I'm sure you're all acquainted. Who hasn't purchased a t-shirt with that symbol on it? Well, there are the four creations in the panels located about the center, immediately about the center. When previous civilizations were said to have been destroyed by jaguars, then by wind, then by fire, then by flood, all of the things that would have frightened and threatened Central Mexicans. But the fifth creation, pictured at the center, is the creation that will be ruled, our time due, will be ruled by the god of the sun and war. And that comes next. And there in the center, you see the lolling, flint-knifed deity beckoning for the blood of sacrifice at the center. But count the hieroglyphs around the inner ring. And if you do, you'll see that there are 20. That's in the ring immediately surrounding the four creations. And so they created a count of 18 months of 20 days plus 5 at the end, 365-day seasonal cycle. Why 20? Well, if you live in the tropics, you're more likely to use your fingers and toes to count on. So that's a vigesimal system, as opposed to the decimal system that we use. You don't have to guess where that comes from. The passage of the sun, I might mention, occurs only in the tropical latitudes. We don't see it get much higher than about within 20 degrees of the overhead position here in our latitudes. I think the change in this calendar to 20 days and multiples of 20 days by the movement of the sun on the horizon was already in full swing by the time the great city of Teotihuacan, near Mexico City, rose to prominence. And that was in the early centuries AD. And I determined that from measuring the placement of stones like these, carved stones. You can see, looking at the stone in the foreground, a double ring of points pecked into the stone and a cross mark in the middle. It's like an axis with a double ring around it, what I call architect's benchmarks. And these were placed strategically in the environment of Mexico, of Tenochtitlan. Two of them align with the twisted east-west Teotihuacan axis. There you see it. They direct the eye to the horizon where the sun goes down 20 days after the equinox and 3 times 20 days before the day of passage through the zenith. In other words, a calendar based on 20-day months marked by positions of the sun on the horizon at those intervals. Why does such a calendar like this make sense in Mexico? Well, I don't want to get too scientific on you, but here's a rainfall chart for Teotihuacan. The rainy season, as you can see, starts in mid-May. The point Z1 is the day of the passage of the first of 2 solar zenith passages. So what do you do in the 20-day months of the dry period? That's December, January, February, March, and early April, leading up to the sudden start of the rainy season that coincides with that seminal day of the passage of the sun overhead. Well, you urge the gods to give you your time due. You create the reckoning of that time in a way that makes the most sense to you. Sort of like our zone time and daylight savings time that makes sense to us. So here's to looking both forward and backward at today's peak turnaround point of our time cycle. Just like the rain god Chak, pictured in one of the pages here of the Maya codices. There you see him seated on his heavenly throne, sun and rain clouds over his head, prognostications and offerings in the hieroglyphs at the top, telling us what we ought to do, what we ought to do to beckon to the god to make the rains occur during this time of planting. You notice that Chak looks both ways in time, backward to the past that we just traversed, and forward to the dawn that lies just ahead. But the doorway to the future remains open to us. And so my wish to you as I close is this. May all of you keep sweet thoughts foremost in your minds, and may you make the seasons do you happen. If you're interested in looking further into these stories, including stories about every holiday of the year, I recommend the Book of the Year, A Brief History of Our Seasonal Holidays, which I wrote for Oxford University Press. Thanks for the invitation, and enjoy the day.